Hi, welcome to P.L. Wooden Exposed. I am so glad that you've taken the time to join me today. P.L. Wooden Exposed is an extension of the Upper Room Ministry where I get a chance to talk to you and to give my opinion on various issues and topics with a thus saith the Lord slant to it. I've been told by people that what Pastor Wooden doesn't understand is that you have to separate religion from politics, or you got to separate religion from this or religion from that. Well, I believe that God speaks to every aspect of our lives. The Bible says in Proverbs 3:6, in all, not some, but in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he will direct thy path. So whether I am talking about elections or politics or laws that are being passed or things that's happening that affect the people of God, I want you to continue to tune in and be a part of P.L. Wooden Exposed. We talk about family issues, judicial issues, entertainment issues, but we want to know what the God of the Bible has to say about these things and how they affect God's people. So stay tuned and tell a friend about P.L. Wooden Exposed.
Mom, can we get some ice cream?
Please, Mom, please.
No, we're having dinner soon.
Please.
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. There are thousands of children in foster care who will take you just as you are.
As for stated, on P.L. Wooden Exposed, I talk about various issues, and also I have guests to join me on this website and to talk about things, and I am excited about the guest that I have with me today. I have in my hand just some of her credentials. She has been an attorney for over 33 years, having practiced law and both in private and public. She is the proprietor of the Watford firm. She has also practiced with the federal law, with the United States Attorney's Office. She is a gospel preacher, a woman of God. She assists churches in the area assists churches and nonprofits. She has greatly, in full disclosure, assisted the Upper Room Church of God in Christ. And here I am today, sitting here, proud to introduce to you a woman of God, Dr. Yvonne Watford McKinney. Dr. McKinney, welcome to P.L. Wooden Exposed.
Thank you so much. I'm glad to be here.
Praise the Lord. Now, Dr. McKinney, a few weeks ago, you preached at our church a message entitled Hiding in Plain Sight.
That's right.
And we're going to talk about that. Okay. But before we talk about that powerful message, I want you to share with our viewers a little bit of who you are. Now, I gave an introduction. It was ragtag. This woman of God is fantastic, and I'm honored to talk with her today. Tell us a little bit about who you are and what you're doing.
Well, I'm the seventh of 15 children born to the same mother and father in Brooklyn, New York.
Yes, ma'am.
I've lived in North Carolina for, I think, about 18 years now. Before that, I was in Michigan practicing law. That's where I went to law school, at Wayne State University Law
School. Wayne State, all right.
And joined the U.S. Attorney's Office after practicing in private practice for about 3 years. Mm. I've been an assistant U.S. attorney for about 30 and a half years now.
Wow.
And I've done almost everything except civil law. Mm-hmm. Specialized in healthcare fraud, other complex frauds, have done any number of kinds of federal cases. I also do work with churches.
Yes, ma'am.
And assist churches in practicing church law. Mm-hmm. Most churches don't know that you really do need a lawyer.
Well, she really educated me
to get along in this world, because everything has a legal component to it.
Yes, yes.
And churches have suffered for a long time because they just don't know that and haven't had that kind of assistance. So that's my heart. My heart really is defending the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And helping churches to propagate the gospel by staying within the bounds of the law.
Yes.
So that's what I That's what I do, and that's who I am.
And she is a powerful, powerful, I'm saying she, you are a powerful preacher.
God bless you, Pastor.
She's a part of the missionary department of our church. As I mentioned earlier, the message you preach, and it did something in my soul. It greatly encouraged me hiding in plain sight. As a matter of fact, when you preached that word on a Sunday morning at the Upper Room, I was out of town.
That's right.
And pastors don't trust anyone in their pulpits, and especially on Sunday morning. Mm-hmm. You knocked a home run. It was a tremendous blessing. As a matter of fact, I took a copy of this message and sent it to every pastor in the Our Own Company Fellowship. And I've heard back from men of God who were blessed by that word. Tell us a little bit about that message. And we're going to make it available for those who are watching on PL Wooden Exposed. You want the message in plain sight, hiding in plain sight. Talk to us about that.
Thank you so much for that, Pastor. That was a tremendous opportunity, and I'm not ashamed to say it was a frightening opportunity as well. I think you recall my expression when you asked me to preach that Sunday morning.
Yes, ma'am.
Because it was just an awesome opportunity, but it was also an awesome risk.
Yes, ma'am.
So I asked the Lord to give me a word, and I did it immediately picking up the phone from you. Because I wanted God to shine through that message. I wanted him to speak to the people what he wanted them to know. And I'll tell you, quite frankly, the Lord led me to Chronicles chapter 26. Mm. And he led me to where he wanted me to go in that message. The point of that message was that governments oftentimes will decree certain things, but they will do it in contravention of Scripture.
Wow.
And when that happens for the believer who is in any kind of position of authority, any area that influence other people, they need to know that they don't have to hide.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Because the Lord will allow you to propound the gospel. And when retribution comes, he will place you in a situation where your enemy will see you, but they can't harm you.
Hallelujah.
And I think some of the things that we talked about in that message had to do with recent events. For instance, we talked about abortion.
Yes, ma'am.
And we talked about whether a fetus is life.
Wow.
And we talked about that. We mentioned Roe versus Wade. And we mentioned in that message that even in the first trimester, we're talking about life.
Yes, ma'am.
When that
yes, ma'am.
Seed touches that egg and conception is made, we're talking about life.
Hallelujah.
And the scripture tells us that. One of the things that I think I talked about in that message was that when Mary came to Elizabeth to tell Elizabeth what she had been told about what was inside of her, the child in Elizabeth's own womb
leaped. Ma'am. Yes, yes.
And we talked about the Lord telling Jeremiah that before you were born, I knew you.
I knew you.
Wow. He didn't know nothing. He knew the child that was forming within the belly of Jeremiah's mother.
Hallelujah.
So these things tell us that there is life at conception.
Yes.
And when we look at Roe versus Wade, the Christian has to understand that legislation does not legislate God.
That's right.
It legislates man.
Hallelujah.
But it does not legislate God. And those of us who believe the word of God, we believe when life is formed and what life is. You'll notice that the opinion in Roe versus Wade did not determine when life begins.
Wow.
The court stayed away from that. What the court did was say, when state can intervene in the abortion decision, and when the state cannot intervene in the abortion decision. But it never said when life begins, because courts can't do that. Only God can do that. And that's what God has done in His Word.
That's powerful, because, you know, here we are so many years later, after Roe versus Wade, and I think we've aborted in this country the equivalent of California, New Mexico, Nevada, the entire West Coast, over 53 million babies, people are missing.
Absolutely.
And God being a righteous God and a holy God, there's no way that the Lord has just written
all of these people off.
As though, I noticed what you said, that the Lord didn't say to Jeremiah, I knew nothing.
Right.
He said, I knew thee.
That's right.
He knew him.
Exactly.
And the fine points of the law, I appreciate your perspective on that, because that's one of the areas where your area of expertise, and more believers need to hear from people who can discuss these things with a thus saith the Lord, but at the same time, knowing what the law says.
Yeah.
Now, there are other trends. And by the way, in the particular message, Hiding in Plain Sight, it was a tremendous source of encouragement for me personally. And it inspired me to stand the more on the Word of God.
Absolutely.
And on the principles of God. So I thank you. I thank you for that word, and it's one of those words that I will keep and review from time to time just to stay encouraged by it. What's going on, Dr. McKinney, in the legal world, if you will? What are the trends that are happening that you would think would be good for the audience to be made aware of?
Well, you know, you asked that, and I did bring with me a couple things I wanted to refer to, because I don't want to forget them.
Yes, ma'am.
Recently, about the 17th, I think, of January of this year, a case was decided in the Middle District of North Carolina. That's the federal district court, Middle District of North Carolina, called Stewart versus Loomis.
Okay.
And this has to do with the Women's Right to Know Act.
Yes, ma'am.
That was passed in 2011, became effective in October of 2011. And there's a portion of that act that is the speech and display portion. And what that speech and display portion requires is that no more than 72 hours before a woman has an abortion, she must submit to an ultrasound. I say submit to, but I'll explain that a little bit further on.
Okay.
She has to have an ultrasound.
Okay.
And the doctor has to administer the ultrasound. And while that ultrasound is going on, he has to show her images of the fetus in her womb, the size of it, the various parts of the body that are developing. And all of this has to be explained to the woman. And the law doesn't try to hide what its purpose is. The law says that it wants to discourage women from having abortions.
Amen.
That's what the law says.
That's what the law
says.
Amen.
Well, this was challenged. Another part of that speech and display is that the woman, if she does not want to listen to what the doctor is explaining to her, and if the woman doesn't want to see the images of the child within her belly, she can have earphones so she doesn't have to hear it, and she can have something over her eyes, or she can close the eyes so she doesn't have to see it.
Mm.
Well, recently, as I said, about the middle of January, in this Stewart versus Loomis case, a federal judge issued an injunction against that part of the Women's Right to Know Act. And the reason is because doctors are being forced to give this kind of information to pregnant women who maybe don't believe in doing that. Mm. Doctors, or some doctors anyway, are saying that it leaves no discretion for them to exercise their own judgment in whether the pregnant woman should receive that kind of information. And it makes the doctor's an instrument or a mouthpiece for the state. Mm-hmm. And on that issue, that part of the act was enjoined.
Okay.
Now the question is for Christians, why should women not be told, whether they want to know or not,
right,
that there is a living child within them, and seeing the child forming and hearing, you know, what will happen to the child, mm-hmm, may change the woman's mind.
Amen.
About whether or not to have an abortion. Mm-hmm. And here, doctors are not to be made a mouthpiece for the state. Now, when a case goes before a court for review, mm-hmm, there are various standards that are applied to a case. We call them, what is the standard of review?
Okay.
Applied to a case to determine how the court should go about analyzing that case and disposing of that case. Here, because we're talking about a constitutional issue that is content-based, speech that is content-based,
right,
it's subject to what is called strict scrutiny, which is a higher level of scrutiny that the judge is going to apply when it looks at a case like this. The government can say what it wants if, mm-hmm, it's purely government speech.
Okay.
Because the government can have what we call a compelling state interest, mm-hmm, in having a part of conduct conform to a certain standard. But in this case, the judge says that when the government uses private citizens to express its own ideology, mm-hmm, which is what this is, mm-hmm, what they say, the state's ideology, okay, is against abortion. When the government uses a private citizen to expound its ideology, mm-hmm, then that violates the First Amendment. And so this judge struck it down. There's another case, very interesting, has nothing to do with abortion, mm-hmm, but this came out just last week, Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals. Has to do with North Carolina's Choose Life license plate. Familiar with that? We've got, mm-hmm, and I don't remember when the legislation passed, but North Carolina passed legislation which allowed the Department of Transportation mm-hmm, to produce license plates that say pro-choice,
or choose life. All
exactly.
Right. Okay.
Well, that was challenged as well. There was a suit against the Secretary of Transportation, Tata.
Wow.
And just last week, Judge Henry Wynn on the Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals out of Richmond, Virginia, struck that down, enjoined that. Why? Because...
So now the state can't print Choose Life?
No, it can't. Because it is discriminatory. I want to use the language because I find the language to be compelling. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but I just jot it down a couple...
Please do.
Notes. It's viewpoint discrimination.
Viewpoint.
It's viewpoint discrimination. In other words, North Carolina limits these specialty license plates saying Choose Life to those who propound the view that life is precious and they are anti-abortion followers. Mm. But there is no license plate with the opposite view. So because there is no license plate with the opposite view, then is viewpoint discrimination. And that's very, very interesting. It's very interesting to me anyway. One of the things that Judge Wynn pointed out about this particular case is that money raised as a result of selling these license plates, mm-hmm, none of that money can be used for any agency, any individual, any entity whatsoever that supports abortion.
Okay.
Which further goes to show this First Amendment violation according to Fourth Circuit federal law now. So it's federal, which means that the states are not only impacted by it, but the states have to follow it. North Wow. Carolina has to follow this law. Mm. Now there is a fix that North Carolina can do if it wants to, and that is that it can allow license plates to be printed with the opposite view.
Okay.
But that is the only way that this license plate statute won't violate federal law.
Well, I hope they allow license plates to be printed with the opposite view, and see who would actually put on their on the license plates pro-abortion. But in it, I chuckled. You said that the Hippocratic Oath is what you alluded to, that doctors are to do no harm.
No harm. Mm-hmm.
And it's amazing to me how that oath does not extend to the unborn.
Because it's not life.
Yeah, but it's life.
Absolutely.
It shows the lunacy
Absolutely.
Of and how wicked it is, you know, and people are putting complex, legal, powerful arguments
exactly
to,
right.
at the end of the day, what amounts to taking a life.
That's exactly right.
I've been criticized by many who said, but Pastor, when you can't legislate your own morality. But it's amazing how they are legislating immorality. And nothing seems to be said or done.
No, nothing is said and nothing is done. You know, the Bible says what it says.
Yes, ma'am.
It says what it says. But people don't take the Bible into courts of law. And they can't, because judges can't legislate. They can't rule on what the Word of God says.
Mm-hmm.
So it's up to you, other people who love the Lord, who love the Word of God, who believe the truth of God's Word, because it's really the only truth.
Mm-hmm.
It's up to those who know and preach and teach the Word to tell a dying world what the truth really is.
Wow.
That life really is life. Life is life, and nobody can take it but Jehovah God.
Hallelujah.
Nobody can.
Right.
Nobody can pass a law and say that because they don't consider a fetus to be a child, that it's all right to destroy that life.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody can do
mm-hmm.
that
mm-hmm.
and risk the consequences, or without risking the consequences, which God has already ordained.
Yes,
we
yes.
We need to follow the Word of God, or we will suffer the consequences.
So you've actually given us then a plan, a strategy to fight for the unborn. First, we need to, in the pulpits, preachers, we've got to preach it. We've got to talk about it.
Absolutely.
We can't say, well, that's just politics.
Mm-hmm.
And regardless to what one's political affiliation
right.
is, the Word of God stands above all of the parties and everything else.
Right.
So we've got to preach the truth, and believers have got to pray.
Right.
And then here's one where I don't, you know, you're there to make sure I don't walk across the lines.
Yes.
We got to make sure that believers then allow their Christianity
right.
and what's taught in their churches to follow them to the ballot box and to cast their private vote based on what they believe the Word of God says, as they have been taught in the churches, cast their votes, and that will affect the law.
That's correct.
Because if nothing else, we can put legislators in who believe the way we believe.
That's right.
Because there are people out there. So there is a plan of action. This is not just a discussion dealing with things that are happening, and we're talking about the problems and there are no solutions. One of the solutions, of course, is for preachers, as Paul said to Timothy, preach the Word.
That's right.
Number two, for us to pray, because, you know, nothing happens without prayer.
That's right.
And then for believers to be Christians in the marketplace, even in the when you vote, everywhere you go, take your Christianity with you.
That's right.
You know, I was taught that we couldn't wear our Christianity like a coat, you know, wear it when it's comfortable and then take it off
That's
when it's not.
Right.
But we're Christians all the time.
All the time.
Mm-hmm. What else is going on out there that you would like to bring to the attention of believers
Yeah.
with regard to legal challenges and changes that are actually taking place in our state and around the world?
Yes. One of the other matters, same-sex marriage.
All right.
You know, this is a continuing saga. I don't know that we're ever going to see the end of the same-sex marriage debate. We all know about what the Supreme Court did in
Yes.
June
Mm-hmm.
of last year when it struck down parts of DOMA, the Defense of Marriage Act, which was passed in 1996.
Yep.
And in March of 2011, the federal government decided that parts of that act were unconstitutional. The part that says that marriage is a union between one man and one woman, unconstitutional.
Unconstitutional.
Because it, and the Supreme Court said that it denied due process of law to individuals who were lawfully married in states that permit same-sex marriage, and also that it denied equal protection of the law. So we're talking about 14th Amendment
Okay.
issues.
Okay.
But one of the things that has happened since then is that we've seen a greater proliferation of organizations, groups, individuals, and even some states who are on the same-sex marriage bandwagon.
My Lord.
Now, we know what the Bible says about a man and a woman coming together, forming one. The Bible didn't say a woman and a woman or a man and a woman. The Bible
No.
wasn't unclear. We can't say that the Bible is void for vagueness because it's not. The Word of God says what it says.
Yes, it's a black and white issue.
Absolutely, absolutely. Just can't get confused about it. But it's interesting to me that in our society now, we're finding states who before were against same-sex marriage being influenced by public opinion, by the residents of the state, and by other states. And they're on the bandwagon now to permit same-sex marriage. So the question becomes, what's going to happen in North Carolina? I don't think there is a small contingency of people out there who support same-sex marriage.
Mm-hmm.
We live in a fallen world.
Right.
And we can expect to see greater and greater instances of people and organizations getting together in support of same-sex marriage, despite what happened on, was it May 8th?
Yes.
Of
2012. We passed the marriage amendment, yes.
Despite what happened.
Mm-hmm.
So for lawyers like me, the issue then becomes, well, what's going to happen when our amendment, constitutional amendment, comes up before a federal court?
My Lord.
Is the federal court going to overturn what the majority of the voting citizens of North Carolina put in place in 2012? You know, I can guess about that. And I guess I think that it probably will find that it's unconstitutional on the grounds 5-4 decision of the Supreme Court. So it wasn't unanimous by any means.
Right.
But I would not be surprised if a federal court were to find that our constitutional amendment violates the 14th Amendment of the United States Constitution. I think, you know, that's going to be interesting to see what happens down the line.
Well, we certainly pray that it doesn't happen. It's amazing what has happened when people reject, and I've said this before, when men reject God's truth, it is amazing what people are willing to believe.
Correct.
Just a few years ago, it would have been laughable. You've been laughed off the stage to suggest same-sex marriage in the South.
That's
in the
right.
Bible Belt, or in the United States of America. But that right before our eyes, marriage has been redefined.
Absolutely.
It basically what as it's continually redefined, initially, ultimately, it will mean nothing. Mm-hmm. You know, and the scriptures, as you said, the scriptures have to be fulfilled.
Right.
The Bible said the time would come when men would forbid marriage.
That's right.
Now we see in the, and unfortunately in the African-American community, too few people mm-hmm. are getting married.
That's correct.
But as the institution is being attacked from the judiciary, from the legal system, from fringe groups, and I believe this, Christians have become cowards. We don't fight. We don't stand up. We cave all the time.
Right.
Even our politicians, who we expected to be our standard bearers, once we go to the polls and vote, the preachers. I mean, we see preachers now.
Mm-hmm.
We see preachers arguing mm-hmm. in support of same-sex marriage.
Right.
We see the NAACP, mm-hmm. An organization that we owe a tremendous debt of thanks to.
Mm-hmm.
Every African-American, every American, but every African-American person of color owes a tremendous debt of thanks to the NAACP. Mm-hmm. But today's NAACP
is not the same
right. NAACP. Today's NAACP would be at odds with Dr. King.
That's right.
Dr. King, I noticed that when today's NAACP speaks of Dr. King, when it comes to same-sex marriage and things like that, mm-hmm. they don't quote Dr. King.
Yes.
Because if you quote Dr. King, you find that Dr. King called a homosexuality a problem.
That's right.
He said to a young man, as a matter of fact, Dr. King actually recommended that he see a psychiatrist.
Mm-hmm.
And Dr. King said that the same-sex attraction that he has was probably not innate, mm-hmm. but something that he picked up from the culture.
Yeah.
Am I right?
That's right.
But today, they speak of Dr. King, this new hijacked NAACP.
Mm-hmm.
speaks of Dr. King on this issue, but they won't quote Dr. King. Because if Dr. King were alive today, Dr. King would be called a bigot, a homophobe,
right.
he'd be called backwards.
All the same stuff.
All the things that we hear on
That's
a regular
right.
basis.
Amen.
But we're on the side of God.
Yeah.
As a preacher, I want to speak to the preacher now. As a preacher, What do you say to that born again viewer that we have today? What do you say to that person who maybe just stumbled upon us today? What do you say concerning walking with the Lord, what the future holds, whether it's in the judiciary,
mm-hmm.
in the legal arena, in the courts or whatever? What is your word to the body of Christ?
Yeah, I think that's really important, Pastor. You know, as people of faith, as people who believe God, we have to talk the truth of God.
Mm.
And if we don't know the truth of God, it's in His Word.
Hallelujah.
You don't have to go find it in the bookstore, you know, and look it up on the computer. It's in His Word. All of God's Word is truth.
Yes.
And it's up to us to understand the promises of God are contained within His truth.
Mm.
And God promised us that He would not leave us, that He would not forsake us.
Amen.
He promised us that if we abide in Him, then we inherit those promises. And He gave us a mandate to go out into the world, into the hedges and the highways and the byways, and to compel people to come in.
Mm.
Because that's where the hope is. You know, we live in this world, and people say churches shouldn't get involved in politics. But you have to understand that politics invades every area of our lives.
Amen.
And you can give it different names.
Amen.
Don't call it politics. I don't really care what you call it. But you have to know that government invades every area of our lives. If you want to drive, you need a license. Got to go to school and learn how to drive.
That's right.
You know, then you got to pay your money before you can get the license. You know, if you want to practice in certain professions,
That's right.
certain professions are governed by laws and regulations. You know, it's against the law to commit certain acts. Everything we do, even the food that we eat, is subject to some kind of regulation. The FDA has got to determine whether it's good enough to eat, whether the medicine is good enough for us to take. All of these things you can call politics.
Wow, that's good.
What we're really talking about is life, is life here on earth. God dictates how it is that we are supposed to live. He dictates how it is that we are supposed to speak. The Word of God tells us how we are supposed to walk, how we are supposed to interact with each other, how we are supposed to have a vertical relationship with Him.
Hallelujah.
And a horizontal relationship with each other.
Yes, yes.
So it's up to us as people of God to get into His truth, to spread His truth. Because the only hope is in God's word.
Hallelujah.
You know, the world is getting worse and worse. You know, and the Bible tells us that evil is going to increase in the last days.
That's right.
Even as knowledge increases.
That's right. Preach,
woman of
God.
And we see the proliferation of both of those things.
Amen.
We can do almost all kinds of things. We have so much knowledge in this world. But how much of that knowledge are we giving credit to the Lord,
Hallelujah.
God, how much of that are we using to get out the Word of God? How
much of that are we even using to study
the Word
of
God?
Yes.
Because the answer to everything is in His Word. So I think that we need to get on our knees. We need to pray. We need to seek God's faith. We need to understand that the hope of life in this world is only in Him. We don't need to get discouraged
as we see. That's good.
Don't get discouraged.
That's
you
good.
Keep doing what you're doing. You keep speaking God's truth. I firmly believe that we need to preach, preach, and preach some more. Because the Word of God is what convicts. We don't know the word that we speak, whose heart that's going to
glory
change.
Glory to God.
We don't know who we're going to turn around, what decision maker is going to have a new point of view, a God point of view, because of God reasoning. We don't know. That's why we have to keep speaking God's truth.
Hallelujah.
That really doesn't matter who you are, whether you're a congressman or a president or a preacher or a teacher or a lawyer, it doesn't even matter. What matters is that we get the Word of God out and that we don't lose heart. And as we see the end approaching every day, that makes us work even the harder. I'm thoroughly convinced that's what we have to do. I want to say a word about people who call believers homophobes and intolerant and all of this other stuff. I want those of you who may be watching to know this. It's not arrogance that causes us to hold the beliefs that we do.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
And it's not arrogance that makes us speak with the conviction that we do. And what it is the word I just mentioned. It's conviction.
Yes.
It's conviction.
Yes.
You know, Paul was able to preach and spread the word and to build all of these churches because he had a conviction.
Glory to God.
When Jesus Christ met him, there was a conviction that took place within him that made him know that it's the gospel of Jesus Christ that saves. It's the gospel that rescues. It's Hosanna.
Hallelujah.
That rescues.
Glory to God.
And that's what we have to have. We have to have a conviction. If we don't have a conviction, Pastor, we won't turn any lost soul in the city of Raleigh toward Christ.
Amen.
We
have
to have a conviction that what we speak is true, that what we speak is going to come to pass because of the Word of God, and there's not one word of the Word of God that will ever fall to the ground.
Hallelujah. What a powerful word. Thank you, Dr. McKinney. My friends, you've heard some legal information. You've heard from the woman of God, the doctor, the attorney, and you've heard a powerful sermon today that should inspire you to continue to serve the God of the Bible and continue to tune in to P.L. Wooden Exposed. Until the next time, may God's choice blessings be yours. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you.
God bless you, Dr. McKinney.
Do your part. Visit feedingamerica.org/hunger and find your local food bank today.